Hey everybody, welcome back to More Fun at the Red Barn. In this episode, we break out the tubing notcher and continue on with fabrication of the lower rear transaxle mounts. And no wood blocks this time. Well, wow, wow, wow. After all the much needed rain here in California, we have ourselves a beautiful day at the Red Barn, and we're gonna continue on with that last drivetrain mount. So with the tube in and still tacked at the front, but positioned where we want it, we're gonna go ahead and cut the pieces for the struts that are gonna run from approximately here back up to the rear part of the chassis. I still need to plate that, but I'm just going to go ahead and rough cut those things and introduce you to another of my favorite tools, the tubing notcher. So I'm going to go ahead and get this set right at zero, zero being a perpendicular cut, so that's what I want to do. And with that cranked down, I can make the cut. And there is a notch tube. Now you can see what I'm after here. This will fit right there. Sharp-eyed among you will notice that I didn't think this through very well. I made the assumption that this was gonna line up, be able to line up where there was absolutely no bend. And it turns out that's not quite the case. It turns out where it kind of wants to line up, it's sitting high, so it's not really going to interfere with that. It's really going to be more, you know, kind of in this area. Anyway, if I line this up widthwise where it needs to be, it's actually partly on that curve, which is not a problem because all I need to do is put this back in the notcher and cut the appropriate amount. Right, because it's going to sit at a slight angle because of that curve. I just have to notch the inside a little deeper. Needs a little bit more. And if you're saying this seems an awful lot of eyeballing, I would say yes. That's how I tend to do things. I would also say there's not necessarily one right way of doing things. There might be better ways of doing things, but a lot of times you just get into what works for you, and this works for me. Telling me now is it's the steepness of the angle, not the depth of the cut. Those of you that are thinking it's a good thing you don't do this for a living are correct, because I am not efficient at this. I like doing it and it's fun, and I don't mind if it takes me 6 tries. Whoops, after all that, I didn't even change the angle. I wonder why it takes me 6 tries, it's taking me 7. And that just makes for a little bit easier view of the fit here. But what we're really after is understanding if that tube miter is now where we want it. And you can see, right, now it's pretty easy to see. It lands right on the curve in order to get it, you know, not too close to the transaxle. Anyway, let's go take a look underneath how we did. So there's the gap on that side, and it's a nice, looks pretty good here. And a little gappy there at the bottom, but you know, again, this is just set in place, and you know, you can see, and that actually looks really pretty. You can see it's flexing around and stuff, so that is completely in range.
Try to fill. So now we know what our setting is on the tubing notcher, and it's not quite 20 degrees. Now we know, and I can go ahead and cut the blank for the other side. So let me go ahead and do that. There are the two blanks for the rear struts. We got our hoop made, and we got our struts cut, and I got some tabs made to start looking at how this is all going to come together. Now, I don't approach things through a computer-aided design rendering of the entire whole setup that what I'm trying to figure out. So oftentimes, as those of you that have followed my LS build on 914 World know, I do things over and over and over sometimes until I get it right or get something I like. And that's what's about to happen here. Now that I've seen the hoop in place and a couple of things that come into play, this has to stay in this plane to clear everything underneath the engine. And we saw that in an earlier episode. I can't raise this thing up. And why would I want to raise it up? Well, if you look at this and the angle that these tabs must sit at, because I want to keep this pivoting link parallel, because that's how Ferrari does it. And who am I to second guess Ferrari on their design? I want this to be here, which would mean that I'm going to take this strut tube out of the way so it doesn't fall on me. These tabs stick up at about a 45 degree angle. And what that's doing is a couple things. One, it's putting a twisting force on this tube because it's, remember, it's trying to prevent fore and aft movement force. And obviously there's no triangulation here. So there's a bending moment in the middle of this tube. Not good, right? You want this to be supported. So after all, what I'm going to do is change this design a little bit. And so what I did was I cut a tube. So it's funny how things work out. This is a 1x2 rectangular tube. And it just so happens, let me take you for a bit of a wild ride. It just so happens that it is the exact same width as what those tabs work out to be. Sorry, as what these tabs work out to be. And so what I think I'm gonna do is just put a couple of hole saw, you know, use the same 1-inch hole saw and end up with a beam. This isn't going to go into place, obviously, because it's not cut to size, but end up with a beam that sits between those two tubes. But you can see then what I'll do is then take these tabs, knock these off of here, and make another shape that then runs back and takes advantage of the fact that it can, you know, it'll run back and take advantage of the fact that there's a support structure in here, and we'll tie it all the way across that beam that'll be sitting in there, that little 1x2 block. So that's point number one, right? And I think it's gonna look pretty good. Mostly it matters that it works well. But the second thing I was thinking, the earlier design was gonna be to try to sneak this tube in right up against, well, close to the transaxle back here, you know, here-ish. And then upon reflection and input from a fellow fabricator buddy of mine, the decision has been made to move this out here to give it the impression of, you know, this being more of a, you know, the same design. I think with the cross tube here, this looks a little more cohesive. And then maybe we'll do a nice little gusset, you know, in this area, maybe a speed hole in it or something, you know, kind of attractive just to tie that together. So anyway, there's the new, I'm going to take you around the bottom. There's the new setup minus that 1x2
connecting the rear of the hoop to that new crossbar. And then of course the tabs are gonna have to be redone, and that'll give it a bit different look, but there we go.
And I gotta work out the back connection, so still to come. But I'm happy with that progress. I think it looks pretty good, and I think it's gonna work a lot better. So there you go, a little bit of making it up as we go along, but that's kind of how we do it here at the Red Barn. Okay, so we're back at the big shop where we're gonna make the little crossbeam part. You can see, well, you can't see from there, but the hole saw just bulged these pieces out. It got thin enough that it bulged it versus cutting right through it. So I'm just going to go zip this through the bandsaw, and we'll have our piece ready to be trimmed up and get into the car. So I like to just do a check fit and get a visual on it here before I start worrying about actually fitting it to the car. Anyway, there you go. Let's go into the car and make sure it fits there too.
And what I'm checking is, as you can imagine, I've got multiple joints here that I need to worry about. I need to worry about this distance being correct relative to the length of this tube and the angle of this notch. So what I'm looking for is where I might have side-to-side rock in any of these pieces. And what I can see is, you might not be able to tell from there, but you can see this crossbar is moving a teeny bit side to side. I don't know that that's worth going after. I'm gonna touch these up just a little bit so that this can be slid forward just a tick, but that's really quite a good fit.
And I had to make a couple of just fine adjustments. I'm really down to the nits here, because that's like a perfect fit. Anyway, and so then once that was done, I went ahead and modified the design of the tab set. I only made one. I like to make one at first and just make sure I like the way it looks and fits. And I'm gonna just hold this together and see if I can present it to you like it's gonna be. So that's how that's gonna work, right? There's gonna be one of these on each side, obviously. But remember, the goal here is to combat the twisting force that that pivoting link has, because it was pushing on this part of the tab. And now you can see, it's now trying to, you know, not only twist the rear tube, but it would have to rip the front tube out of the cradle or bend it. And it's not gonna. And remember, these are rubber mounted parts. So this is a bit of overkill, but I'd rather over engineer something than worry about a failure point. But there you go for today. I feel like that's good progress. And I really think that's gonna look cool under the car. Not that you'll ever see it, but we'll know it's there, right? All right, be back soon. Here's the quick design on the tab that I just made. And now we're gonna go ahead and cut the second of them. Anyway, there you go. One tab. Yes, having a plasma table is like cheating, but I'll take the cheat every time. Well, that turned out to be a lot more work than I thought it would. But the good news is we got all the parts ready to go for next time. So looking forward to that. I hope you enjoy what you're seeing. And if you have questions or comments, leave them down below and I'll get back to you as quick as I can. Thanks for watching. Y'all take care and we'll see you real soon. Bye-bye.